English. So I'm very happy to introduce Jackie Rechi Garcia. She did her PhD in Instituto Astronomía in Mexico City under the co-supervision of Miriam Peña and Pablo Velázquez. She got her PhD degree in July of 2018, so she's 2 years since she's been a doctor. Then she went to Granada to work with Martin Guerrero for a short postdoctoral research stay in last year for 6 months, more or less. And she came to Morelia since last year. She started working in our group. And legally, since March 2020 of this year, she started working as a postdoc, Tegapa postdoc. Jackie is interested in planetary nebulae. In particular, she studies outflows from planetary nebulae, the jets or bipolar ejections, fast ejections from protoplanetary nebulae or young planetary nebulae. She will speak to us about her most recent work, and probably she will mention what she's been working lately. So let's all turn off our microphones, our cameras, and let's just hear Jackie.
Okay, well, hi everyone. Thanks to be here. So I hope that you are fine in these difficult times because pandemic. Thank you for the invitation to Sundaram Vicente to give this talk. My English is not good, but I'm going to try to explain my job in this language, but be patient with me. And in this talk, I'm going to talk about collimated outflow in planetary nebulae. As said, Jesus Tolos, I'm work with him and other collaborators with Martin Guerrero and Sara Casoli in Granada, España, Jesus and Mauricio Gomez here in Morelia, and Gerardo Ramos in the Universidad de Guadalajara. So in this talk, I'm going to give a summary of my recent paper and also a summary of the planetary nebulae that I studied in my PhD. And finally, I'm going to talk about the different projects that I'm working here in the IRIA. And before that, I'm going to thanks to different people, because when I arrived here in Morelia, they helped me in different things. So thank you, Jesus, Jane, Will, Vitapata, Brutual, and other researchers and students, of course. Okay, so we know that planetary nebulae, they represent a highly evolved stage of low intermediate mass star. This means that a star with an initial mass of 1 to 8 solar masses will become a planetary nebulae. The density of this object is 10^4 particles per cubic centimeter for a slightly extended young object, and 100 particles per cubic centimeter for extended young objects. The temperature for planetary nebulae is 5,000 to 20,000 Kelvin, and the surface temperature of the central star is more or less 20,000 to 300,000 Kelvin. So in the right image, we can observe different planetary nebulae. And also, one of the most important things in this image is that we observe different morphology of this object. So we found, for example, bipolar planetary nebulae. I can't point it. Who can do that?
Para eso tienes que ir a configuración. Will also knows that how to make the pointer appear.
Configuración. Okay, well, I'm going to continue because I can't do that. Well, in this image, we can find different morphologies of planetary nebulae. We can observe bipolar planetary nebulae, quadrupolar planetary nebulae, spheric, round, etc. So approximately 80% of planetary nebulae are asymmetric. This means that show ellipsoid, bipolar, or multipolar morphology, displaying Dory, Jet, Knot, etc. So one of the most intriguing questions is, how can the formation of such component be explained? I can move. Okay. So in order to answer this question, we have two possible answers. The first one is are magnetic fields. In 2014, Garcia Segura suggested that although magnetic fields help to form asymmetric planetary nebulae, they are insufficient, they are not enough. So he said that it's necessary a binary system. However, in recent paper from this year, 2020, they built Garcia Segura other model using magnetic fields, and they find that the magnetic field can produce bipolar planetary nebulae. So this revives the idea that magnetic fields are a precursor of bipolar planetary nebulae. So in the image that you observe in this slide, this is the result of the model of Garcia Segura in his recent paper. As you can, he used magnetic field, as you can observe the bipolarity of this model. So furthermore, a recent study by Laurent Sabin found that in the Cavalage Nebula, the inferred magnetic field vector traced an hourglass morphology centered on the central system of the nebula. So both recent paper reinforce the idea that magnetic field can produce bipolar nebula. The second possibility and the most accepted, that is the origin of asymmetric planetary nebulae, is due to a binary system in the center of the nebula. There is a recent paper of Sol where they built a model considering a binary interaction. So I'm going to read this part. So he said in this paper, we have shown that by beginning with full 3D common envelope simulation as an input, it is possible to drive a strongly bipolar outflow from a maximally uncollimated wind from the post-AGB star or remnant binary system. So in this paper, again, they built a model using binary interaction in the center of the nebula. So in this image, you can observe one of the results of this model. And you observe this bipolar jet in this model. So both possibilities, magnetic fields and binary interaction, can answer the question in order to say what is the origin of asymmetric planetary nebulae. And both are still in discussion. In a recent work in Granada, in my first postdoc, I studied 12 planetary nebulae with possible fast collimated outflows. And we found three different types of jets. The first one is jet-like collimated outflow that you can observe in figure one. So in this planetary nebula is N166. And if you see the blue arrow, you can observe this jet-like in this H-alpha image. And also in the same figure one, to the right, there is the position velocity diagram. And you can observe the same jet light, but now in the spectral observations. Other planetary nebulae that present this kind of jet light is then figure two, that this is the second planetary nebulae, M240. And the jet light is pointed with the red arrows in the image and in the position velocity diagrams. Okay, so the second type of jet that we found is multiple or precessing collimated outflow. For example, in the case on the NGC 6210, this is a Turtle Nebula, you can observe two pairs of outflows. But in a recent work that Wilkeny told us 1-2 weeks ago, they found, if I remember correctly, they found that this plantain nebulae has five pairs of outflows. So there are other plantain nebulae. For example, in figure 4, we have M3-1. That these plantain nebulae show a point symmetric type. It means that they show a S-shape morphology. And due to this morphology, they are believed that they have a precessing collimated outflow. So this is the second type jet that we can find in this planetary nebula. And there is a type 3 of jets. This they present bipolar planetary nebulae. And they look like a V-shaped, like a letter V. And for example, this is the case of GNIS 2-115 in figure 5, figure 6, and figure 7, the other planetary nebulae. And for example, if you observe the figure 5, we have the bipolar lobe, but they have a V-shaped form. So this is the other type of jet that we found in this project. So basically, there are two types of outflow can be described. First, true collimated outflow that have radial velocity bigger than expansion velocity of the planetary nebulae, and jet-like or precessing morphology, as I showed you in the past slide. And the second one is spatial kinematical evidence of the action of collimated outflow on the nebular shape. This means the lobes that has a V-shaped. And in this table, I show you a summary of the different characteristics of the planetary nebulae. We have distance, radial velocity, morphology, expansion velocity, and other things. Some other work that I do in my first postdoc was a statistical study of collimated outflows in planetary nebulae. I did a kinematic study. Here we have presented an analysis of the kinematic and spatial property of a sample of 85 jets. And this was detected in 58 planetary nebulae. So in this work, I searched in the literature for a recorded radial velocity. And from the literature, I got the distance, the angular size, the different velocity, etc. And the important results of this work is the next. In the first graphic, we have the expansion velocity of the planetary nebulae. And in the y-axis, the number of planetary nebulae with this expansion velocity. This graphic or this distribution indicate that planetary nebulae with jet have a median value of 22 kilometers per second for the expansion velocity. So you can observe the median in this graphic. And the second graphic or the second histogram, we have the number of outflow with their corresponding radial velocity in the x-axis. And in this histogram, we find that jets in planetary nebulae can be assigned to two different populations. Most, as you can observe, have a low velocity with a mean space velocity of 66. And only at 30% have a larger velocity with a mean of 180 kilometers per second. So in summary, with this work, we found two populations. Planetary nebulae with jet at moving at low velocity and planetary nebulae at moving at high velocity. So now you know that there are different types of jets in planetary nebulae. You can observe a beautiful planetary nebulae in that in the image that I showed you. You know that there are different velocity for the jets in planetary nebulae, and they have different morphology. But there are other planetary nebulae that have jets, but the jet is not clear, is not seen in an H alpha image or in a nitrogen image. We detect this bipolar outflow in a spectra observation. For that reason, we call this kind of jets in planetary nebulae as spectroscopic collimated outflow, because this bipolarity or this collimated outflow is only found in spectra observations. So in my PhD thesis, I studied this kind of object. Basically, they have these characteristics. I studied a compact planetary nebulae. More or less, the diameter of this planetary nebulae is 10 arc seconds. This is very compact compared with other planetary nebulae that have 30, 40, 50 arc seconds in the diameter. So the other characteristic of my sample were this planetary nebulae with central type Wharf jet, and also this planetary nebulae have a jet moving at high velocity, more or less 100 kilometers per second. So this is the first planetary nebulae that I studied in my PhD thesis, is N132. So if we observe the image, that the title is Observations, at the left, you can observe my planetary nebulae. Well, it's not mine, but that planetary nebulae that I studied. And this planetary nebulae looks like a donut, like a toroidal structure, and maybe with an elongation. But this planetary nebulae is not more spectacular than like other planetary nebulae. I put a square in the corner in order to remember the other beautiful, really beautiful planetary nebulae. And N132 is not beautiful that this other planetary nebulae. Maybe it looks like a little boring. But the interesting is not in an image. The interesting is in the spectra observations. So if you observe the position velocity diagrams in the same figure, you can observe that we have two condensations. If you see the middle of the position velocity diagrams, you can observe two condensations and also material moving at high velocity. That means maybe that this planetary nebulae has a jet, but this is only evidence in spectra observation. And in my PhD thesis, in order to model this planetary nebulae, I built a hydrodynamical model. You can observe in this image to the right. I'm not going to develop about this model, but basically this model have two components, a jet moving at high velocity, and the second component is simulating a structural toroidal structure component. And the synthetic position velocity diagram, that is the result of this model, you can observe here in the same slide. And this is pointed with a red arrow. So we can compare very well with the observation. We have two condensation and material moving at high velocity. So the result of this model is that the reason for that we don't see the jet in an image in H alpha or nitrogen or other filter, the bipolar outflow, is because this outflow is along of the line of sight. There are other planetary nebulae that I studied in my PhD thesis. This is the case of N315 and H167. And also as N132, they are very compact. More or less, they have 10 or 12 arc seconds. And I studied this planetary nebulae using long slit, the MES spectrograph in San Pedro Martin. The slits are the red square and black. So in order to map all planetary nebulae and get the observation, the complete kinematics of this object, we need to map, we need to use different slit in different positions. For example, in the case of N132 and N315, we use three slides in north-south. And in the case of H167, I use two slides. First one is north-south, and the second one is oriented at position angle of 45 degrees. But there are other techniques that maybe you know, that is the integral field unit. So this technique provides spectral information over a two-dimensional field of view using instrument known IFUS. And this technique is distinct from previous spectroscopy, which obtained spectra at only a single point, or long slit spectroscopy, which provides some spatial information, but only along a single slide through an object. As I said before, you need to locate different slits in the planetary nebula in order to have all the kinematic information. But applying integral field spectroscopy, we obtain the spectrum of all the points of the two-dimensional field. So there is an instrument that maybe you know. The name is Megara. That it means a multi-spectrographo en GTC de alta resolución para astronomía. And in this image, you can observe the different parts that compose this spectrograph. We have the collimator, the VPH grating that works like a filter, a camera, the CCD, etc. So this instrument, this spectrograph, is located in the Islas Canarias. I put a square in the map. And in the image, in the right image, you can observe the Gran Telescopio Canarias. So this instrument Megara is attached in this telescope. And this instrument have two mode observations. The first one is a multi-object spectrograph, that is a MOS mode that you can observe in the right image. And this mode is useful to study deep sky or very distant objects. And the size of the field is 3.5 arcminutes. But there are other modes in Megara, that is large compact bundle. Hereafter, I'm going to say IFU. That the size of this instrument is 12.5 times 11.3 arcseconds. So this field is very compact, and could this instrument could design it, or seems designed to study compact planetary nebulae, like my sample. The power, the resolving power for this instrument. We have a medium, a slow, medium, and high resolving power. For our research, we are using the BPH that have the most resolved power resolution, that is more or less 20,000. And you can observe the BPH is 665. In the wavelength, more or less in center in H alpha, 65, 62. And the idea is using this BPH in order to do a kinematical study on different planetary nebulae. So, which are projects in IRIA? Well, first, in order to continue study compact planetary nebulae, that in my PhD thesis, I searched different planetary nebulae that have these characteristics. They are very compact, they have jets moving at velocity, and I found three planetary nebulae that you observe here, into T1, into T27, and in T8. And these planetary nebulae have jet moving at high velocity, as you can observe in the position velocity diagrams, that is below of the image. More or less, the velocity of this jet is more than 100 kilometers per second, so the jet is very fast. So in the case of N2-31 and N2-27, there are not a good image, so we are not how this planetary looks like. In the case of N338, there are Hubble Space Telescope, there are HST H alpha image, and we can find that they have a collimated outflow. So the idea is to study this planetary nebula, this compact planetary nebula, using Negara. We sent a proposal using GTC. This was approved with category C. But due to the pandemic, we are not sure when we are going to obtain this spectrum. But this is a project that I'm doing in some moment. The second project is the Eskimo Nebula. This planetary nebula, has a complex morphology that you can observe. It has a multiple kinematic component and it's nearly Bolon orientation along the line of sight. And Garcia Diaz in 2012 built a 3D morphokinematic model of this planetary nebula. She did a very detailed work about this planetary nebula. They used 21 slits in order to cover all the planetary nebulae and come to study all the kinematics of this planetary nebulae. And they present a comprehensive spatial result, high resolution, long slit spectroscopy mapping of the scheme of planetary nebulae. And this data set allows us to construct a velocity result nitrogen channel map of the nebula with a resolution of 10 kilometers per second. And they, as I told you, they built a model using the software shape that I show you in this slide. Because in the slit U, that this is inclined in this image, they found a spectroscopic collimated outflow. So we can observe this collimated outflow in this position velocity diagram. You can observe this collimated outflow at less 100 kilometers per second and also in 240 kilometers per second. And they do this model using shape. This model is the figure 7. And this model is rotated 90 degrees in order to observe the different components that they use in order to construct the model. So they have a ring, they have an inner bubble, they have a bipolar jet in this part. And one of the results of this model is that they say that using the same model for a Eskimo Nebula and using different rotations, they can found that this model can be similar to other planetary nebulae. So in the second image, in the below part, we have the synthetic image of the result of this model. And they rotate, I don't put the angle, but they rotate this model. And they found that this model is very similar to this planetary nebula NGC 6543. So this is a relevant result because using the same model, you can find different morphology of planetary nebula. And using the information of the paper of Garcia Diaz, we found that this jet has a broad, and we put using the 21 slit, we put in this image a red boxes in order to trace the jet that Garcia Diaz do. And the idea is to study this jet. First, in the last year, Mauricio got different observations using the mass spectrograph. And we observe, for example, that in the slit 4 and 5, for example, the position velocity diagram that they have a green contours, we observe the jet, but very very weak. But if we observe the slit 3, well, the number is very small, but if you can observe the slit 3 that is in the north of the nebula, that it is from 6 arc seconds from the star, we can't to observe this this jet. So the idea is that this jet has a broad, as Garcia Diaz told us in the past article. And the idea is to study this jet using Megara. So we have a different observation. In total, well, here I present only 14 fields, but we have 20 fields in order to study this planetary nebulae. And the reduction were done by Mauricio and me. And the idea of this project is considering all the information that is known, one on one hand from kinematic study by Garcia Diaz, together with the X-ray study by the Central Star by Guerrero, with the new data that we are analyzing from the Central Star using the spectrograph CAFE, that I'm working this day with this data, and with the new observations on Megara. So considering all this information, some objective of this work is mapping the full extended of the jet, study its ionization structure, its velocity, and trace the density of the jet. Furthermore, due to the multiple fields of Megara on this planetary nebulae, it's possible to study the kinematics and density of the different cometary nodes seen in this planetary nebulae. So you can observe, for example, the field 11 or the field 12, that the field is centered in this cometary node. So it's very useful use Megara in order to study the density or the velocity or different things. So we have a lot of information using this instrument. And the last work that I'm doing in IRIA is to study this planetary nebulae, is IC2003. The idea is that this planetary nebulae is very compact, more or less the diameter is 10 or 15 arc seconds. And the star of this planetary nebulae is classified like a warfare jet, but this is not clear, so we need to do a study more deeply. And there are spectra in the San Pedro Martir catalog, but it's a little difficult to interpret the kinematic due to there isn't a good image. So Guerrero obtained, using the Nordic Optical Telescope, an image of this planetary nebulae. And if you observe, this is very similar to Eskimo planetary nebulae. So you can observe that in the outer shell, it has different nodes, similar to Eskimo nebula. And the idea with this object is to study the kinematics and the central star. So maybe on vacation, I'm going to work of this nebula. And it's all. I don't have to return and see you.
So we have questions.
No sé.
¿Qué quieres hacer?
Sorry, I was talking without my microphone on. I can take the question.
You can do it.
Thank you.
Perdón, es que no había visto.
Okay, everyone, raise your hands if you have questions. Thank you, Jackie, for the very nice talk.
Estás hablando, pero sin micrófono, Jackie.
Sí, ya, creo que ya. So, tienen algunas preguntas, bueno, igual puedo contestarlas en español. Nada, creo. Todo muy claro, todo muy aburrido.
Yo tengo una pregunta. Si vas a, I have a question. If you go to, what are your first figures when you show the spectroscopically detected jets? Those are very compact planetary nebulae with jets. At the beginning.
¿Podrías preguntarme en español?
¿Tu tesis cuando pusiste los jets espectroscópicamente detectados?
Ajá.
¿Podrías ir a la imagen? ¿Dónde está tu simulación, la imagen?
Sí.
Ajá. ¿Por qué en tu simulación tú lanzas jets o bolitas, pero en la observación tú no ves eso?
Sí, una de las cosas, digamos, que no están, que no comparan bien justo con las observaciones son estas zonas calientes que se ven en el diagrama sintético, ¿no? Lo que sucede en el modelo es, por ejemplo, si vemos la, el diagrama, el, ¿cómo se llama? El modelo hidrodinámico que está arriba del, del diagrama de sintético a 4500 años. Esa zona, la última zona donde llega hasta la parte final, está chocando con el medio, ¿no? Entonces se está calentando, hay un choque ahí. Y ese efectivamente no lo vemos en las observaciones, ¿no? Entonces es una de las cosas que no comparan bien con las observaciones y el modelo.
¿Y cuál crees que sea lo que tengas que hacer en la simulación? Porque si te fijas en la observación, se va, el brillo va bajando, bajando, bajando.
Sí, de hecho, por ejemplo, aquí no lo no puse las otras, los otros diagramas de posición velocidad sintético, pero por ejemplo, cuando yo me muevo en el modelo sintético, cuando muevo la rendija, el brillo de las zonas finales también va disminuyendo, pero esto sucede porque la rendija está un poco más a la orilla del modelo, entonces ya no agarra, digamos, todo el jet completo, sino solamente una parte. Entonces...
Pero, por ejemplo, al principio mostraste que hay jets, hay como diferentes jets, ¿no? Unos que son como pelotitas que han sido lanzadas, otros, el del esquimal es continuo. ¿Cómo, qué crees que, por ejemplo, aquí este modelo le faltaría para reproducir? O sea, ¿tiene que ver con el jet?
¿Que el jet? Pues mira, nosotros hicimos varias pruebas. Por ejemplo, una de las cosas para que se haga esta triangulación o esta forma de triángulo que se ve ahí, tenía que ver con el tipo de estructura toroidal que nosotros metíamos. Entonces, pues, hay unos parámetros que se llaman A y B, que básicamente tienen que ver con la geometría del, del disco y con la densidad que tiene este en el ecuador con respecto al polo. Y diferentes discos te daban diferentes formas del, en el diagrama posición-velocidad. Entonces, a lo mejor, usando otros parámetros, nosotros... pues usamos algunos parámetros para A y B, sí hicimos algunos mapeos, pero bueno, seguramente no utilizamos todas las posibilidades, ¿no? De estos parámetros. Entonces, a lo mejor moviendo estos valores, podría, podríamos conseguir esta, esta disminución en, el, en, el, en los bordes del, del jet.
Ahí, perdón, que me meta.
Sorry,
pero también. Sorry, I'm gonna.
One second, yes. No, let Will go first because he raised his hand and then I'll put you on the list. So Will, go ahead.
No, it's, if someone has a particular point to raise about what they were talking about, then they should go ahead.
Fair enough, okay.
Yeah, where it's me.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, Will. I was just wondering, estaba yo nada más pensando en esto, Jackie.
Sí.
Estabas hablando en un momento de campos magnéticos, ¿cierto?
Sí.
¿O no? ¿Por qué no incluyeron aquí campo magnético en el modelo y solo es hidrodinámico?
Porque, por ejemplo, como decía hace un momento, ¿no? En el, cuando nosotros hicimos ese trabajo, que fue en el 2019, o ¿de qué año es? Déjame ver de qué año es. Está publicado. 2017, perdón, ya no me acuerdo de mi trabajo.
¿Qué con 2009?
No, en el 2017, un trabajo previo de García Segura, del 2014, ellos hacen un modelo... usando campos magnéticos, García Segura es el que ha hecho campos, incluyen campos magnéticos en sus códigos, para ver si estos pueden producir nebulosas planetarias bipolares. Entonces, ajá, ellos, de hecho hay un párrafo hasta el final del artículo donde justo dicen que el campo magnético, aunque ayuda a formar planetarias asimétricas o planetarias bipolares, realmente ajá, realmente es insuficiente, ¿no?
O sea, ok, sí, pero no digo, o sea, en las simulaciones que ustedes tienen hidrodinámicas, no están ajá, formando ningún toro, ni están formando ningún nada, lo están imponiendo.
Sí,
lo que no digo es, si ya tienen eso, ¿cuál sería el efecto de, si ya tienen eso y lo están poniendo nomás en la simulación, poner campo magnético?
Pues,
¿cuál es el efecto que tendría?
Claro,
no de formación, porque ustedes no están haciendo formación, ¿no?
Sí, nosotros estamos imponiendo desde el, como tú dices, ¿no? Estamos imponiendo desde el principio un disco allí y un... Y un
exacto. Entonces, no digo la formación del flujo bipolar, sino cuál sería el efecto del campo magnético en, sí, tus simulaciones estas.
Sí, yo lo que creo es que uh-huh, si uno pusiera campo magnético en estas simulaciones, la forma que tiene el jet sí cambiaría. Porque justo en estas últimas simulaciones de García Segura, usando otros modelos hidrodinámicos, dicen que en realidad el campo magnético sí ayuda a formarlo. Entonces, en estas simulaciones que yo tengo, podría ajá, ser que si incluimos ese campo magnético, la forma del jet varíe.
Ok, porque ¿pondrías campo magnético al jet? ¿O pondrías campo magnético también al toro? ¿Pondrías campo magnético?
Por ejemplo, yo lo pondría en la parte del jet. Porque, por ejemplo, en
el trabajo... toro?
Podría ser también, ¿sí? O sea, podrías ponerlo también en las dos componentes, ¿no? Y ver qué sucede. Pero pues habría que hacerlo para saber qué forma tendría, ¿no? Pero a priori yo diría que la forma, por uh-huh, lo menos del jet, definitivamente iba a cambiar.
Ok, gracias, Jackie.
Thank you, Vero. Will?
Ok, perdón. ¿Estamos hablando en inglés o en español? Español, ¿verdad?
Español, sí, perdón.
Ok, sí, sí. Me veo olvidado. Yo tenía como una duda respecto a los diferentes tipos de flujos bipolares, ¿no? Que en tu estudio habías dicho que encuentras los jet-like y los que son forma de delta de V, ¿verdad?
Sí.
Pero también hay muchos que son de baja ionización, ¿no? Que son los flyers.
Sí,
eso es simplemente que por las líneas que estás usando, que no estás detectando este tipo de flujo.
De hecho, por lo menos para estas 12 nebulosas planetarias, no encontramos estos flyers, pero efectivamente hay otros objetos donde, uh-huh, donde están estos flyers, ¿no? Que de hecho en el estudio cinemático que nosotros hicimos, consideramos, además de los jets confirmados, flyers dentro de estos objetos.
Uh-huh. Porque en la tortuga, en NGC 6210, ¿sí? Ahí encontramos que hay dos tipos de flujos, ¿no? Hay los que son los tipos de choque de prueba, tipo jet, que parece que pueden ser consistentes con lo que estamos viendo es la nebulosa chocada. Y hay otros que son de muy baja ionización y muy densos, y demasiado densos comparado con la nebulosa por ser consistente con un choque en gas ionizado. Entonces, hay dos posibilidades. Uno es que eran choques pero producidos antes de la ionización de la nebulosa, cuando la velocidad de sonido era mucho más pequeño y se puede alcanzar mayor compresión, o que eran eyectados como bolitos, ¿no? ¿No? De las estrellas centrales.
Sí, y también la...
Si en tu muestra más amplia tú habías encontrado este tipo de...
Sí, en la muestra, bueno, nosotros tomamos básicamente uh-huh, en esta muestra datos uh-huh, de la literatura, ¿no? Pero sí que hay uh-huh, De hecho, bueno, es una lista bastante corta, pero en la lista grande de estos 85 jets ponemos cuáles han sido clasificados como jets, cuáles son clasificados como flyers. Y a lo mejor otra posibilidad es que, por ejemplo, en alguna nebulosa planetaria el jet a lo mejor ya haya viajado lo suficiente como para no detectarlo en la nebulosa planetaria, ¿no? Entonces digamos que ahí perderíamos un flujo bipolar también.
Okay. Otra pregunta, si me permite, cuando encuentras dos tipos de velocidades, ¿no? Encuentras una población que es la mayoría, que son de velocidad baja, y otra población de velocidad alta, ¿hay alguna diferencia entre las nebulosas planetarias, ¿no? Por ejemplo, si algunos tienen diferentes abundancias, vienen de diferentes poblaciones estelares.
Pues en este trabajo no nos fijamos en la parte química de las planetarias. Digamos, no buscamos cuál era la razón, ¿no? Por la que presentaban estos dos tipos de velocidades. Lo que sí es que hay un trabajo de Balik en donde ellos dicen que hay dos tipos de jets, los ligeros y los jets que son un poco más densos, y que esos probablemente sea la razón por la que se puede encontrar baja o alta velocidad. Pero bueno, en este trabajo la verdad es que no fuimos más allá de checar qué tipo de abundantes eran, o que eran viejas o más jóvenes, ¿no? Lo que encontramos es que, en general, con toda esta estadística, los jets son de muy baja duración, más o menos una edad promedio de unos 3.000 años. Entonces, bueno, son jets bastante jóvenes, ¿no? Y una posibilidad, lo que yo decía, es que a lo mejor puede ser que hay jets más viejos, pero que estos ya viajaron, ya están lo suficientemente lejos de la planetaria, como para que no los podamos detectar, ¿no? Entonces, quizá ahí tenemos un bias de detección de este tipo de jets.
Ok, gracias.
Sí.
Thanks, Will. Are there any other questions? If not, let's thank Jackie again for the excellent presentation.